Dr. Rajendra Pratap Gupta is considered amongst the top thinkers globally and global evangelists for digital health. He has served on the Global Agenda Council of the World Economic Forum from 2012 to 2014 and is one of the most influential and sought-after public policy experts in India. He was conferred the Global Healthcare Leader of the Year Award in 2012 by the Sheriff of Los Angeles and has been named the Thought Leader of the Year 3 years in a row by ICT Post. He's been invited by global organizations like the International Society for Telemedicine and mHealth. He's currently chairs Continua India, Personal Connected Healthcare Alliance India, Innovation Working Group Asia, amongst others. He holds a master's degree in leading innovation and change from UK and bachelor's degree in science and social sciences and is currently pursuing his doctorate in healthcare. Ladies and gentlemen, request you to put your hands together while I welcome Dr. Rajendra Pratap Gupta, advisor to Union Health Minister, MOFHW, Government of India, deliver the keynote address.
Still doing my doctorate, so I'm not doctor, so first writer there. And till they set up the presentation, let me tell you, how many of you were there in the Philips Healthcare Conclave yesterday? There's your hands. Oh, great. So we had a very interesting banging that bell rather than lighting the lamp, which is more environmentally friendly. I think we should move to digital lighting someday. So what I'm going to do is walk you through. You know, before they started, we were talking to some of the friends and they were saying that next 2-3 years we'll see a huge change in digital health. And I would say not 2-3 years, next 1 year. I'm going to walk you through what's happening and what's going to happen over the next 1 year. I think that's a very exciting time that we are in, and there's a big paradigm change in the way we look at healthcare IT. And what's going to change, I'm going to talk probably on that in this presentation as well. I'm happy to take questions as well. One of the things I want to talk about when our Honorable Prime Minister took office in 2014, in one of his earlier addresses, he said, I envision a digital front for every Indian. And in that talk, he talked about the electronic health records. So that was his vision under the digital India, and health being an important component of it. So how have we gone about it is what I'm going to talk about. Or I'm not able to handle it. Sorry, apologies for this group of. Okay, let me first give you findings of a survey which was done with 60,000 people in 22 states. So the findings that state that 80% of the households have a mobile phone. You see the numbers that use it for health is astonishing. Something that I don't believe, but since it was a face-to-face survey with 16,000 people, we have to go by the numbers. A decent number of people use it for healthcare. And I think this is one of the driving points for us to see, let's leverage the mobile platform for healthcare. This is another survey that is being done with 2,300 doctors in 12 states. It's again a face-to-face survey with 2,000 doctors and 300 with online doctors. So the findings say that 55% of the doctors are aware about ML and there is some amount of usage of mobile health in their practice. 53% are aware about telemedicine, you use it in some form or the other. The usage is actually small compared to the awareness. And electronic health records, the awareness is 64%. So if we see the awareness of digital health among doctors is definitely short of what it should be, but it's still high. This is important, I don't know how many of you tracked this year. India was the only country probably to table a resolution at WHO. And that was mHealth, which was supported by 35 nations. And if this is something that people see in the light and the perspective what the ministry thinks, India wants to be a global digital native. So there are a couple of initiatives that the government has done in terms of mHealth, and the reason for that is efficacy and efficiency of walk you through some of the mHealth initiatives of the government and what we are trying to do. And these are the most important part is these initiatives are done in partnership. None of them is done by the government on its own. It's done by vendors. So when people ask, is there a scope to work with the government? Absolutely, you will see all these initiatives are implemented by private vendors. So this is a Swasth Bharat app. One of the things we felt was that there was a huge deficit of trustworthy information in the government and in the public, and we needed authentic sources of information through the government. So this is an app launched where you get information on healthy lifestyle, diseases, and symptoms. There is an app on training voluntary health workers, it's called Gelgari. There is a vaccine tracker app. We have seen that immunization rates were pathetically low and they were growing at a very small percentage. Last year, the growth was phenomenally high. We have used an app to act as a reminder to people through mobiles, even the kind of usual family drama. Every year we have this incidence of dengue and chikungunya, and there is a big issue in terms of where do people go, where do you get the blood. So this app was launched again this year. So you will see a whole lot of initiatives happening this year on using mobile health and digital technology. Okay, this was just a coincidence that demonetization happened on the 8th of November and 9th of November this app was launched. Nothing to do with the stress related to demonetization. It was just a coincidence. It was developed much earlier, but getting the timelines of the minister was, you know, just coincided with the demonetization. So this is an app, a very interesting one, which if you log in and see, keying in some data, you can figure out at what level of stress you are. Either you are in the green or in red or in yellow. And based on that, it tells you what steps you need to take to manage your stress. This is again an initiative of the government, not done by us, done by people from the private sector for us. The tobacco cessation program that we have developed with the World Health Organization, and this has got last review I think I did in May, was 2 million users. That shows the success of the program in terms of the number of users that we have got into this. And one needs to just give a missed call on this number to get registered for this app. Again, an app on diabetes management, again developed with partnership with WHO. This is again a missed call base. If you registered it giving a missed call, you get alerts daily and even tips to manage diabetes. Prime Minister had a very innovative idea saying, let's provide free services on MCH and public facilities. But the question was how to get people to register for that. So again, this app was launched to make sure that people can volunteer and register on this app to provide the services on the 9th of November. This is probably a unique program for tuberculosis control, where we have 6 million users. So 6 million is a huge number. You won't get them unless they find benefits of using this app. This is doing exceedingly well, and we also have a missed call alert for the TB patients, which has been done currently in the states of Punjab, Haryana, Chandigarh, and Delhi, in large more states. This is probably the oldest mother and child tracking app, MCTS, which was launched a couple of years ago. And this is probably the 94% of most of the apps that they have created to be IR. This is a very important project. We are talking about digital health and we work on digital health and we work on digital numbers. So this was a project started where we are giving unique number to our community. As of last month, we had 2,40,340 facilities allocated to the national education. And all facilities to the big number. Yesterday, we were talking, you know, in the conference of private hospitals saying they will start online registration system. So some places government has been very hard. This online registration system so far has given out 400,000 OPD appointments. So again an app developed where people can register COPD appointments. It's actually in 48 hospitals. It makes life a lot easier. In fact, AM recently started a test for medication. Patients don't have to basically go to AM for follow-up for surgery. That's a big relief given the fact that people come from all over the country to AIMS for consultation and follow-up. And it's not a very convenient journey to be at AIMS. It's an e-hospital which is available, and it's over 30 large hospitals are using e-hospital and 7 hospitals are using the cloud version. It's also a strategic move to cloud. There's an inventory management system in case we rolled out. Also, one of the things we felt was that all these initiatives are played from rolling out perspective. But how people are comfortable, what is their feedback? So a lot of times, you know, in the government there is always issue, let's not accept the negative feedback. But say whatever is the feedback, let's hear from the people. So there is an app which people can send their feedback on the services that they get. It gives us a scope to improve on what we are offering currently. The challenge with blood banks in terms of when you want to get a blood group of a particular type, you're not getting it, it's not available. So one of the initiatives is to bring it online, live updates on the blood banks and the blood group available across the country. So we have initiated this. This is something I want to spend some time on. When people talk about IT and they say that IT is great, but you don't have electricity for 24 hours, there are issues in terms of how much. Now, this is a program which has been running for a couple of years, and the numbers that talks here is 41 million smart cards, 11 million hospitalization cases handled through smart cards, cashless, it's all for the bottom of pyramid, unorganized workers. It's been in rural India and urban India most, so it tells you that yes, that we have been really successful. Of course, there could have been roadblocks, but getting 41 million people on smart cards and then handling 11 million hospitalization cases gives us a sense that yes, if it comes to rolling out a large project, we definitely can do it better. So my understanding is the new health protection scheme, this is going to be the template. This is the template. All those people who have been saying that, you know, adoption is tough, doctors will not come, challenge, let me tell you that national health protection scheme is an announcement of the budget. It has to be rolled out by April next year. Budget announcement cannot go beyond that. Going to provide 100,000 coverage for families, 130,000 for families having disability. Now, and this is going to cover almost 400 million people, probably one of the biggest insurance schemes. How would you roll it out without technology? You're going to have panel small clinics, you're going to have panel hospitals. If you do not have, they don't have basic IT systems in place, how will you get e-approvals, payments? And this is going to be backed by standard operating protocols and guidelines. How will you comply to it? So for those of, you know, kind of hospitals and doctors who think that we're still 3-4 years away, are probably living in some food paradise. So if you don't do my MBL, probably you still want to be a part of NHPS. And remember, this NHPS claims and the entitlement can change the balance sheet of a lot of hospitals. 1 lakh per family and 1,30,000 is not a small money. We are talking some 400 million people getting more. So I think IT adoption, if one major factor can drive adoption, this is the national protection system, it will be a game changer. People will have to adopt it. There is no other way you can be a part of it. So if not April, I think by December next year people should be using it. So we have also described some of the organizations. Because one is program, another is organization. So the national organ and tissue transplant organization from the registry to retrieval, all is not transparent and you have to log on to the registry to be a beneficiary of the program. Same is for the cancer registry program is digitized. We have the central drug standards control operation digitized. So licenses, renewals, all is online. So we talk about corruption to submit applications and renewals, it will pass. Same is with the food standards and safety authority of India, it's digitized. So approval, licenses, reports, all are now online. This is another important project, and I must confess that I came to know about it last month when I was reviewing this with the Honorable Minister. This is a wonderful resource. It's actually a gold mine for researchers in healthcare and medicine. The National Medical Library has got the repository of thousands of PhD theses, lakhs of books, journals right from 1939, and they said digitize it. Now this is available, but it's still limited to public institutions. So one of the requests we have made is let it be available to even private people who want to use this wonderful resources for research and review. So this is another digitized library available. So electronic health records is the building block. If you don't have EHR, you don't talk about digital. The good part about India is that being a late starter, we have a lot of benefits. And we have different advantages from the learnings that we have from other countries. So we are probably the only country where the standards have come first, solutions will come later. In other parts of the world, solutions came first, standards came later. So people have rolled back a whole lot of things, which is a very painful process. So the first standards came in 2013, and shortly we released the 2016 data. National Health Portal was launched again in 2014. The first year of the government, to say let's provide one source for people to log in to get information on health. National Health Portal is a one-stop shop, even for tenders or RFPs related to digital health, this is the place to log in, not the MO chapter group website. There's a voice portal, so if people want information on diseases, health programs, and other tips, this is IVR based and a toll free number. Available in multiple languages. We have a health portal of directory services. We are actually now listing individual practitioners. We want to list all the doctors and see who are practicing doctors and then make that directory available. There are a lot of innovations happening in the private sector. Now the question is, when you get a lot of innovation, we are doing this innovation, how do we take it manually? This is a portal initiated by the Ministry of Health, launched last year in July. It's hosted by the National Health System Resource Center. If you have innovations, you can actually log in and submit your innovations. There's a National Medical College Network, and the whole idea is to provide tele-education and tele-consultation. So we have put public health facilities, 50 of them to start with, and connected the remote health facilities like the PHC, the CHDs to this, and this will probably be scaled up based on our learning from this initial phase one. This is a project very recently we have pushed in, realizing that sending doctors to rural India is not going to happen anytime soon. There are infrastructure issues. But there are studies right from Mayo Clinic to private providers where we have seen that 65% to 80% of the time we actually don't need a doctor. People just need a medical advice which can be given over the phone, which is for acute issues. Why not have a doctor on call over phone? So we're going to launch these services early next year in 16 languages across the nation, free of cost. It's not going to be any cost of making the call and provide advice on ailments over phone. This probably is going to be something which has been missing for decades, and people don't have to go and crowd the district hospitals for basic things. So, for decades we have been talking, at least for one decade I have been a part of advocating let's give a big push to digital health. But the challenge was that it's not that in India this didn't happen. You know, we had digital health in pockets, we had in silos, it's happening. Things are happening, projects are good, they're doing well. But then there's no institutional push. So if there's a good bureaucrat, he's on for digital health, the project will move. The moment he gets transferred, you get someone who is not on for digital health, the project will end. It's always a project or a program, and money was always there, but it never scaled. So one of the thoughts in the government was, let's provide an institutional push. So this is a body that's going to come to an act of parliament, National Digital Health Authority, which is going to look at frameworks, standards, human deployments on digital health. This probably is the biggest shift on pushing digital health. So when people say, next few years, I say, no, next 1 year. Another big thing is the National Health Information Platform, IHI. This is the health information discussion exchange. We are getting to the RFP stage. We have had issues and discussion with the industry. We had the expression of interest. This is probably going to be the biggest IT deployment project in the country. It's to set up the health information exchange. I think we have talked for a few years. This is not an old concept. But this is now in deployment. So also you will see one big change is that all the talks that have been happening is getting translated into action. All the projects I have talked to you here are either done and available for use, or these are in the phase of deployment. There is a discussion forum on MyGov. There are seven discussion headers there. So if you have ideas, if you want to discuss something on the MyGov portal, it's already available. But the next big thing that is happening is this. See, most of the people reach out to us saying, we want to give input, we want to be a partner in digital health. We have some exciting stories to tell, we have experience to tell, we have got expertise to share. So one of the thoughts that came in that why not set up a think tank in the ministry, which is partnered and initiated by the Ministry of Health. So this is something that is in the process of being set up. Just about that, and I chair the committee for the formation. So what it's going to do is going to be a think tank for the Ministry of Health on digital. It will have people from private sector, from the public board. It's going to be co-chaired by one government official and one private sector. So this probably is going to be an organization which will give regular input to the government on digital health. And I would encourage each one of you to be a part of this as it gets rolled out, so that all those great experiences and the talks that you keep doing on forums or even one-to-one gets translated into complete input for the government. Because digital health is, yes, game changer, but we say that public facilities have the expertise, it will be like partly wrong. I think all of us have to come together and work together to give the right answers. The last slide is, when we are saying universal healthcare, trust me, it won't happen without digital health. The precursor to that is digital health for all. Otherwise, neither there is universal, neither there is health, neither there is care. That's the reality.